Model virtue. It is well known how oppression and ethics, morale, converge in the renunciation of the drives. But the ethical ideas do not merely oppress other ones, but are immediately derived from the existence of the oppressor. Since Homer, the concepts of good and wealth are intertwined in the Greek language. The kalogagathi, Greek perfection, which was upheld by the humanists of modern society as a model of aesthetic ethical harmony, has always put a heavy emphasis on property, and Aristotle's Politics openly confessed the fusion of inner value with status in the determination of nobility, as inherited wealth which is connected with excellence. The concept of the polis, Greek city-state, in classical antiquity, which upheld internalized and externalized nature, thesen, the validity of the individual, individuum, in the city-state, and the individual's self as a unity, permitted it to ascribe moral rank to wealth without inciting the crude suspicion which the doctrine already at that time courted. If the visible effect on an existent state establishes the measure of a human being, then it is nothing but consistency to vouchsafe the material wealth which tangibly confirms that effect. As the characteristics of the person, since the latter's moral substance, just as later in Hegel's philosophy, is supposed to be constituted on nothing other than their participation in the objective social substance. Christianity first negated that identification in the phrase that it would be easier to pass a camel through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter heaven. But the particular theological premise on voluntary chosen poverty indicates how deeply good and to have goods coincided from the beginning. Good people are those who control themselves as their own possessions. Their autonomous nature, Wesen, is modeled on material dispositions. The rich are therefore not to be accused of being unethical. That reproach has ever belonged to the armature of political oppression. But given to understand that they represent ethics, morale, to others, in this latter is reflected having habe, wealth as goodliness, good sign, having goods or being good, is an element of the mortar of the world. The hard-bitten appearance, shine, of such identity hinders the confrontation of the moral idea with the social order, in which the rich are right, while at the same time determinations of what is ethical, different than those derived from wealth, cannot be conceptualized. The more that the individual, individuum, and society later diverged in the competition of interests, and the more the former is thrown back on itself, the more stubbornly do individuals hold on to the conception of moral nature, Wesen, as wealth. It is supposed to vouch for the possibility of reunifying what has been divided in two, into inside and outside. That is the secret of the innerworldly asceticism, which Max Weber wrongly hypothesized as the limitless exertion of the businessman ad majorem Dei gloriam, Latin, to the greater glory of God. Material success binds individual, individuum, and society, not merely in the comfortable and meanwhile dubious sense that the rich can escape loneliness, but in a far more radical sense. If the blind, isolated self-interest is driven only far enough, then it passes over, along with economic one, into social power and reveals itself to be the incarnation of a universally binding principle. Whoever is rich or acquires wealth experiences what is attained by the ego, by one's own initiative, as what the objective spirit, Geist, the truly irrational predestination of a society held together by brutal economic inequality has willed. Thus, the rich may reckon as benevolence what testifies only to its absence. To themselves and to others, they experience themselves as the realization of the general principle. Because this latter is injustice, that is why the unjust turn regularly into the just, and not as mere illusion, but born out of the hegemony of the law, according to which society reproduces itself. The wealth of the individual is inseparable from progress in society as prehistory. What, however, the reason of state of the almighty economy so cynically confesses, reaches unacknowledged into the mode of conduct of individuals. The generosity in private intercourse, which the rich can presumably allow themselves, the reflected glow of happiness, which rests on them, and something of this falls on everyone who they consort with, all this veils them. They remain nice, the right people, in English original, the better types, the good. Wealth distances itself from immediate injustice. The guard beats strikers with a billy club. The son of the factory owner may occasionally drink a whiskey with a progressive author. According to all desiderata of private ethics, morale, even the most advanced kind, the rich could, if they only could, in fact always, better be than the poor. This possibility, while truly indeed left unused, plays its role in the ideology of those who do not have it. Even the convicted con artist, who may anyway be preferable to the legitimate boss of the trusts, is famous for having such a beautiful house, and the highly paid executive turns into a warm human being the moment they serve an opulent dinner. Today's barbaric religion of success is, accordingly, not simply counter-ethical, vida moralis. Rather, it is the homecoming of the West to the venerable morals, sitten of the fathers. Even the norms which condemn the arrangement of the world owe their existence to the latter's own mischief, unwesen. All ethics, morale, is formed on the model of what is unethical, unmoral, and to this day reproduces the latter at every stage. Slave ethics, sklaven morale, is in fact bad. It is still only master ethics, herren morale.